Okay, so tell me, you have an idea what administrator does and what developer does, how infrastructure is framed? If not, I'll start from the scratch. Okay, then that's fine, that's fine, we'll do it. So try to understand things like this. Now I'm Mr. A, okay, wanted to develop some website for my organization. I wanted to start a business, so I wanted some website to be designed and provided to me. For that, I'll just go and meet some company, okay? That company will provide me an output, maybe a website or maybe some other, you know, application, whichever is needed towards my organization or towards my business. Then what I'll do is, when I just go to a company people say, yes, we will provide the application, website, whatever you need towards your business. And then they'll engage their developers, because always, whenever when an application needs to be created or anything to be designed, a developer needs to write a code. That may be a Java code, that may be a script, you know, that may be set of commands in another language. So anything, a developer develops the application. That's what the duty of a developer. In order to do that, okay, in order to develop the application or website, anything it is towards the end of my business, that's Mr. A's business, the developer needs to develop the code or whatever it is. Once it is executed, okay, it will finally give us the output, and that output is shown to the client, that's Mr. A, who wanted the application. And once he is satisfied with the output, then we say, okay, project is done, then we will deliver the project. But you know, when a developer wanted to work or build that application, okay, he must require a computer. And not only a computer with proper OS and proper configuration, suitable configuration to build his application or the client's application. And to build that client's application, including the configuration of computer and OS, he also required suitable applications to develop that. For example, if it is a Java code which he needs to write, the developer needs to write, he needs the Java application to be installed in it. If it is another application and he wanted to, you know, test that, for testing that application he wanted some testing tools kind of thing. So anything it is, a developer needs a ready-made system with all the suitable applications and OS and all installed in it. So that computer, in our language, in IT language, we say that it is a server. Okay. And you know, the server may not have enough space. Like for example, you know, when we buy a laptop, now these days, of course, we are getting TVs of hard disk. But earlier, prior to that, we used to get laptops of somewhere around 500 gigabytes or 360 gigabytes of space. What happens if that space, you know, totally filled? We may have to go and buy or extend our hard disk. Now, these days, we are having options of buying external hard disk. In the same way, in our real time or in our infrastructure, IT infrastructure, we have an additional storage to be built or to be added to that. So additional storage is that what? Now, you know, in our real time scenarios, we say SAN storage or EMC storage. These are all separate storage providers. Okay, so when we take that storage, rather we keep this entire application's data which we are trying to build towards Mr. A, client Mr. A, we will, or the developer is advised or suggested to keep or instructed to, you know, store all these data in the storage separately. Or a particular share is provided from that storage to this developer to, you know, work in that storage share only, whichever the project is working on. So that entire data related to that particular storage will be stored in that share, whatever we provide. And entire data will be safe. Okay, and it will not affect the server. So now understand, what's a server? Server is nothing but any computer or any machine or any box with all the suitable softwares and applications installed in it readymately towards a developer, whatever and however the way computer is needed. That is generally known as a server. So server or a machine or a computer or a box or an instance, in our AWS language we call it as an instance. So anything means the same. Do not get confused now in the future whenever I say instance or a server. It's just a computer with all the softwares installed in it. So when you know people are a developer works on that and you know stores all the data in the storage share which we have provided, it's fine, he's doing his job. But in order to run this server and you know able to connect to that storage share whatever we have provided, everything should function properly. It's nothing but you know the computer should work properly. What way it needs to work? It needs to boot properly, which means the OS should work properly. So who will deal with the OS? If there is something wrong, if something you know a nasty is happening in the OS, who's going to deal? Does that developer checks out, look into the issue, whatever is happening? His duty is only to develop. He doesn't need to know what is OS and how a system works. So who's going to handle it? The other person, the administrator, which is nothing but we people going to look after the health check of that server. So we administration guys are going to handle all those issues about a server and it's being healthy and running properly, up and running, to work and to be able to work by this developer properly without having an issue. So we admin guys, in what way we support, we maintain this server up and running. Okay, an OS guy, that may be Windows or Linux, you guys are learning Linux, right? So you need to maintain, you being a Linux admin, you have to maintain that the OS Linux is properly working. And if I wanted somebody, some users to be created in that, so you have to create users into that, you know. And if I wanted you to check the disk space into that, you have to check the disk space and then maintain the disk space properly without, you know, completely filled. So everything you Linux admins have to maintain about the OS Linux. If it is a Windows, then it is Windows guys will be taken care of. And after that, on top of that, there are some supported softwares installed into it. Those are nothing but applications. So who's going to handle all those applications? Applications team will be there separately. So when you take an organization, an infrastructure, there are so many, a number of people work for that organization towards one particular project. So what way it is defined? It is just like this. When you just define or talk about an administration, there are n number of teams. Let's understand this way. An OS guy always checks whether the OS of that computer is working fine or not, so that the computer is booting properly. An application guy checks whether all the applications are working fine or not, so that the developer can utilize this server very fine to you know maintain the system. To develop his application or write the code, anything it is. And when people are working, okay, when developer is working about that particular project, how about somebody else gets the access to this computer? That guy can do anything with that, right? So we should be very much careful towards our server that nobody gets the access. So what we have to do, we should be very much careful about our server that it should be very securely configured. So security comes into picture. Okay, and while we are developing this, the user may be somewhere and the developer may be somewhere, they always wanted to connect to this server and log into it, then work. So in order to do that, we do not provide the access to the server directly. What we do, we share the, when I say SAN storage, okay, the storage in that I'm just giving a little piece of share, a little piece as a share to this particular project. So when I'm giving this little piece as a share to this particular project, they should be able to connect to that. When they need to connect to that, their network should be proper without having any issues to connect to that. So network admin will be there, security admin will be there, that storage should work properly, so storage admin will be there, okay, OS admin, you guys are there, I mean including AWS, whatever it is, okay, and what else, application guy should be there, and if this data should be backed up, since it is an important project, and if something goes wrong, entire data, if some disaster happens and entire data is corrupted, what happens? That entire work is lost, gone. So to be safer side, we always take the backup of all the data into another remote location. So if something goes nasty with the current data, we go restore our entire data back. So backup admin will be there. Like this, a number of people work towards a computer to run it properly so that a developer can log into it and work and develop whatever the client requires. Hope you got some idea about infrastructure, what a developer does and what we admin guys does. Okay, so this is how the IT infrastructure works on. Now, when I come to infrastructure part, infrastructure is nothing but what it is, a data center we say. A data center is nothing but combination of servers, a number of servers. See, one project, it's not compulsory that you need to have only one server, or sometimes when the project is very huge, one server may not be able to, you know, meet up the requirements. In that situation, we may have to build our infrastructure in a great way, like maybe 3 to 4 servers towards that, you know, project, and storage and networking in between that, then security, all this comes into picture, routers, switches and all this comes into picture when we wanted to build the data center. So all this data center is the combination of servers, storage and the, you know, network communication which establishing between them, all this together known as, you know, a data center. So we admin guys are going to take care of this data center. But what happens if you wanted to build the data center physically? All these days we used to handle with physical data centers. Okay, with physical data centers we used to handle all these days. Somebody is joining into the class. Looks like Usman is having some problem. Fine. Are you all getting my points? Hello? Am I making any sense to you guys? Or I'm going faster or not able to reach you? Hello? Okay, fine. So now, of course, we are now entering into the main core concept. Okay, let's discuss now this way. So what I'm saying, the data center. Infrastructure needs a data center. Okay, so that the data center is maintained by admin guys and the developer logs into that a computer or server, works properly and, you know, then develops the application towards the client's output or requirement. Now you see, when we wanted to establish our organization, we must need a data center. Okay, whatever I said, like number of servers, storage, network, security, all the stuff. In order to, you know, design or build a data center physically, what we have to do is, I'll just give a little example. When you wanted to buy a computer, what do? You just go to, you know, if it is Hyderabad, you go to CTC and you inquire 3 to 4 shops about the, you know, price of your own computer, like whatever the configurations you wanted. Once after you inquire, you decide which, you know, dealer is providing you a best computer or a proper or required configurational computer according to you in a low price. So that's nothing but we have to get the quotation from the people in the market. After once we get the quotation, we should analyze which person is giving us the required hardware, that's nothing but software, servers and storage and all, in lower price. So that needs to be approved. Once quotation is approved, okay, once you decide, okay, from which shop or from which dealer you wanted to purchase your laptop, you go pay money, then purchase it. Once after you purchase, you'll get your machine, but do you get that machine ready-made, I mean, like completely and readily available for your work? No, not possible, right? You have to install your OS into it. That may be, for our computers, what we do, we generally go with Windows 8 these days, Windows 7 or Windows 8. And to install that, they probably take almost an hour to 1 hour, minimum of 1 hour they take to install and everything into that, including the drives. After once your OS and drivers are installed into it, will you be able to use your computer according to your purpose? What you do, you just come to home and then, you know, install. For if it is just like you have to practice Linux, you come back home and then, you know, you install VMware into that or VMbox into that, and after once that is installed, you know, you take ISO file and then install your Linux and all, and that takes another couple of hours. After all these stuff, then maybe if you go to the shop in the morning, maybe in the afternoon or in the evening, your machine will be ready for you to use your purpose. So this is how so much of time it is taking. And when it is about a server and about an infrastructure, what you do, you have to first finalize the quotation, then place the order. After once the order is placed, that order should be approved. Then they send the hardware to our location. After once we receive that hardware into our location, that needs to be fixed. Once after it is fixed, all the OS and supported softwares are to be installed into it. And you know, after everything is installed, you have to test whether that data center, that server is working fine or not. Once after you conclude everything is working fine, then you keep or you make that server live for your production. Production is nothing but to your work, to develop whatever the things you wanted towards the application. So we make it alive for your production. And till then, in real time, to establish an organization, it takes at least a couple of weeks and you may have to spend lakhs of rupees. Okay, now you have a project. Fine, you're getting revenue, you're building it, that's pretty much fine. Okay, pretty much fine, you got everything. What happens once you're done with your application, once you're done with your project, your entire data center is just unused. It's just idle. You're not at all using. Of course, you have any other project, it's fine, well and good. But what about if you do not have any project at least for a couple of months, then it's waste. You are not utilizing your investment. Your investment is just kept like that without being used. So you have to, you know, worry, go find, try to get the, you know, projects and all. This is what the really challenging thing. But what happens if we go into cloud, you know, the advantage with the cloud is that is our AWS. What we are going to talk, every cloud is the same. We have so many clouds in the market, but now since we are going to learn about AWS, I'm talking in terms of AWS. If you are trying to go build your infrastructure into AWS, that may be a number of servers, storage and all, it probably take 10 to 15 minutes of time to build entire your infrastructure, just a matter of 10 to 15 minutes of time. And you need not to pay that huge lakhs of rupees. You just pay in terms of the number of services you utilize per amount per so much of time, for any amount of time you utilize it, just like your postpaid. Okay, you postpaid connection, you speak to anybody, how much ever you speak, only for so much you pay. In the same way, you utilize all the services. I'll just come to that point, Usman. Let me complete this. You will try to understand what way it is. Okay. So when we try to utilize, in order to, you know, develop our infrastructure, what and all the services we utilize in our cloud, okay, based on that, and how much time we are using that, based on these two components, what services you are utilizing and how long you are using it, based on these two components, you are charged. So you are paying only for the amount of resources and for the amount of time you use that. What happens? You know, you are working on a project, so you took the infrastructure from cloud and you finish your work, you finish building that application. Then you can inform AWS people or cloud people saying that you are done with your work, so that they terminate that infrastructure from you. Terminate in the sense they take out that infrastructure from you, and you are paying less, you are paying zero. With this, you know, you can save your money, you can build your infrastructure in minutes of time, you can complete your work, and what else you wanted? Then later on you get one more project, you go buy another infrastructure, finish your work. So this is how you can manage in cloud. With this, you are saving your time, you are saving your money, okay, and you are able to meet up all your clients' requirements, and fine, your work is done without any problem. So this is what the advantage with cloud. Now let's try to understand what cloud computing is. Okay, to understand cloud computing, I'll just explain this way. So try to understand cloud computing. Once we are done with this cloud computing, I'll let you know how many cloud providers are available in the market. So cloud computing is nothing but understand with this five attributes. There are so many definitions available in Google and there are so many people defined in so many different ways. But let's try to understand with these 5 points or 5 attributes what cloud computing is. The first thing is, you know, cloud computing, cloud is nothing but an open space created, okay, from a physical hardware. And that open space is not only utilized for one organization, but anybody can build their organizations into it. So when n number of people can create their organizations into it from any corner of the world, and that needs to be accessed over internet, okay, over internet, it must have broad network access. This is what the basic thing is. So first thing, whenever we say cloud computing, it must need to have a broad network access so that anybody can access it from any corner of the world. The second point is, okay, on demand. On-demand self-service, I can say. What do you mean by on-demand self-service? Now you see, you wanted 2 servers for your infrastructure on the spot. You wanted to, you know, you just order them and then get that. It's not that like physically you have to go find out which server, which shop person is providing you for less amount, and you get that, install everything, you know, and then make it, test it. It's whether it's working fine or not, and then make it alive. Nothing like that. You just demand something and you should get it on the spot. You wanted 2 servers for your infrastructure, then you should get 2 servers in a matter of no time. That's what on-demand self-service. You demand them, rather you request. You demand and you should get it. That's what on-demand self-service. Anything you wanted, you ask, they will get it for you. The next, pay as you go. This is very pretty much important. Pay as you go. or you may pay as you go. Okay, it's not like when we go buy something physically, when we establish a data center physically, whether you are done with your work or you have projects, anything, you have to keep entire your hardware with you or you have to sell it to somebody else. Okay, so that's all dealing with the hardware, and also it's time consuming because you have to wait till you get your hardware and then get it ready for your production. And once after you're done with your work, then you either have to sell it or wait for some other project. So that is again time consuming, whether you need to sell it to somebody or you know you are waiting for some other projects. Anything, you may lose some amount in that and also time. But in this case, okay, if not that entire investment is just waste, lakhs of rupees is just wasted. But in this case, in our cloud, what you do is you build infrastructure, you use it. Once your work is done, you inform them saying that you are done with your work so that they'll take back your entire infrastructure and you'll be paying only for the amount of time you utilize. So pay as you go refers, you pay only the services and only the amount of time you utilize. That's all. So you are paying only some thousands of rupees in infrastructure when it is, you know, created or built in cloud. In physical, it takes lakhs of rupees. And here, it is created in a matter of minutes. As I said, there it takes a couple of weeks. So that's what pay as you go. You pay only for the amount of services and only for the amount of time you utilize. This is very, very important thing, pay as you go. The next thing is, understand this, it's really very important. A rapid elasticity. What do you mean by rapid elasticity? For example, I'll just simply tell you, elasticity means what? You take a rubber band, stretch it, it will stretch. Leave it, it will get contract. The same way, now I'll give you another example. You have a website built. Maybe, for example, Amazon.com or Flipkart. Okay, any website, any e-commerce site when we take. Or if you guys are very much interested in watching cricket, then quickinfo.com will take. People when, you know, who hit these applications or these websites will be constant. For example, per day, some thousands of, maybe for example, we take some 5,000 of users access this site, any site with, out of these three examples I have given. You consider any site in your minds. So generally I'm talking for an example. Every day, let us understand, for example, 5,000 users are accessing these websites. But what do these people do? They sometimes conduct some big day sales or some occasional sale or end of season sale. During that day, people are notified well in advance saying that so-and-so day, so-and-so sale is going to be happen. So what do? They try to access that site in a huge way. And the best example, I'll give you one more thing is, booking system, IRCTC. Normal timing throughout the day, the people hitting to this site is very constant so that everybody can access that IRCTC site. But during Tatkal time, maybe it's around 11 o'clock or around 10 o'clock in the morning, are you able to get the server access that easily? No, it's not possible because, you know, people hitting to this site will increase a lot than a normal time. So how do we deal with that? Have you ever heard the servers have gone crashed due to huge load onto it? So how do you define that huge load? For example, if you take a server and if that can hold or that can serve some 2000 requests hitting to it, and all of a sudden some 6 to 8 thousands of requests come on to that particular server, how long will it be able to serve? If its, you know, limit is serving 2000, it may go extend up to some 3000 or 4000, but all of a sudden 6 to 8 thousands of requests come all of a sudden and hit that server, it may not be able to bear such a huge load so that it go crashed by itself. It's not at all reachable to anybody. So how do you plan your infrastructure. Okay, now you have a website built in, and that's you are doing some business building that website. Maybe you are providing some service, or maybe you are selling something, some provisions or something. You have planned something to reach out. Okay, now these days online grocery stores are also have opened. So something like that, you have planned and built something towards your own business. Of course, your site is generally having some 4,000 users requesting every day, are accessing your website every day for something or for buying something. All of a sudden, or occasionally, you are just planning for some occasional sales, like discount sales. During these discount sales, will you be having same level of access that 4,000 users accessing your website, or it will be different? Obviously, it will be different, right? So it will increase. When we announce that there will be a discount sale, obviously people who are accessing to that website will increase. But how long, to what extent it get increased? Do you have any idea? Can you expect anything, whether that 4,000 goes up to 10,000 or 16,000, or it may go up to 5,000 only? Can you estimate anything in this situation? It's not possible. Okay, we may just roughly expect something, but that expectation may not be correct all the time. So without knowing anything about your website access, how many users are going to hit your application, how will you plan your infrastructure? That's not possible. So if you have 4,000 users accessing your website every day, and those 4,000 users are request are being able to serve by two servers comfortably, and if you are expecting that your website is gonna hit somewhere around 10,000, then you may have to plan for 5 servers. But are you sure that your website is going to hit with 10,000 requests? If 10,000, and if you have 5 servers, it's fine, it's well and good. If not, okay, our expectation is 10,000. So we have planned, we have established our organization, our infrastructure with 5 servers. But what happens if our estimation go wrong? In either ways, there are two ways we understand. If it goes beyond our expectation, like some around 16,000 requests come to our website, what happens? Will those 5 servers which we have will be able to serve the requirement? Do they? No, right? No, obviously no, because our infrastructure is framed to serve 10,000 requests only, but 16,000 requests have come to our server. So how do you meet up that? Your servers will become inaccessible because such a huge load hitting your websites. So it's not possible to meet the requirement. They may become very slow to access for the people, or you may not be, are cases that either of your servers go crash. Okay, this is what happens. You are finally not meeting your requirement. You are finally not reaching out to your customers properly. In other way, what happens? 10,000 you have expected. If not 10,000, if it is just hitting only around 7,000 requests, for about 7,000 requests, some 3.5 servers or maybe 4,000 per maximum are enough. Okay, let's say 6,000 requests only have come. Those 6,000 requests are handled by 3 servers comfortably, quite comfortably. What about those 2 remaining servers which you have established or which you have bought for your infrastructure? That waste of money, right? Waste of money you are spending unnecessarily. So in either ways, if your expectation go wrong, you are not meeting your requirement. If it is lesser than your expectation, you are paying unnecessarily. If it is more than your expectation, you are not able to serve your requirement. So this is where rapid elasticity comes into picture. So how rapid elasticity does, like a rubber band, how much you stretch, it will stretch, and if you release it, it will get contracted. The same way we have some mechanism in our cloud. Physically, it's not possible. Like, why it's not possible. Your website is having huge load. Okay, you wanted to increase number of servers. Physically, is that possible? Go get the laptop or get the server and then install every application and do that, and then by then it is ready for you. Your sale will be completed. Your sale will get over. So physically, it's not possible. It is possible here in the cloud. That is by another mechanism called auto-scaling. Okay, what do you mean by auto-scaling? So auto-scaling is two ways, scale up, scale down. So either ways it does. So scale up means one moment. So scaling up is what? When your servers experiencing huge load, this auto scaling automatically spin up instances or spin up servers on the spot within no time, so that the load hitting to your existing servers will be distributed to newly created servers, okay, and you will be able to meet up your requirement. Once if your site is experiencing less load and there are few servers not utilized being idle, then automatically this auto scaling will scale down. Earlier it scaled up created servers, and now it will scale down, which is nothing but that idle servers will be removed, so that you are charged only for the amount of time you utilize, and end of the day you will be able to serve entire your requirement. Are we done with that? Does that make sense? See, whenever you wanted, you will be able to create servers. Whenever you don't want, you are deleting them. So finally, you are finishing your sale quite comfortably without any disturbance. So this is what rapid elasticity. And then, okay, your website, you have a website, every day some 4000 requests are hitting to your website. In couple of months your website has become popular, and now you are getting 6000 requests per day hitting to your website. Okay, so what happened? From two servers you have gone to three servers. Okay, in the end, after once you have gone to three servers, in another couple of months your website has become even more popular. So now every day you are experiencing 8000 requests. You are getting 8000 requests to your website. So what do? You have to increase your infrastructure again. You need to increase your number of servers from 3 to 4. But what you have decided is, okay, now my site is getting popular day by day. So in the future, it may become even more popular. So thinking about your future, instead of going with 4 servers, you have planned to go with some 6 servers, for example. Okay, thinking that 12,000, your request will become, 12,000 every day. You have gone with 6 servers. What happened? Of course, your site has become popular, but not up to 12,000, but it has gone up to 9,000 to 10,000. So in this situation, you are only being used 5 servers. One more server is not being used. It is just idle. But still you are paying for that, so why should you pay? And if you don't want it to, if you wanted to remove that, in the future, if your site becomes popular again, you have to buy it. So now you can neither terminate it nor pay unnecessarily without using it. So what do? In this situation, we have another option in our cloud computing, that you keep your additional resources into the marketplace, where somebody else utilize that and pay on behalf of you. Like carpooling, you're just going somewhere in your car and you're going all alone. If you find some passengers on the way and then you give a lift to them, so you can expect some money from them. That's how you can, save your money, like in terms of fuel. You can just, bear that fuel charges with all That's what, like car pooling, resource pooling. You have additional resource, you keep it in the marketplace, so somebody else utilize that and pay on behalf of you. That is what resource pooling is. So anything which meet these five attributes is cloud computing. First thing is broad network access, on-demand self-service, pay-as-you-go, rapid elasticity, and resource pooling. So these five attributes means cloud computing. Are you sure? I mean, are you clear with this? You got things clearly? Yes? Shall we move on to the next thing? Fine. That's fantastic, Srikam. Let's move. So I said cloud. Usman was asking some doubt, like what are the cloud providers? Like how many cloud services are there in the market? It's not cloud services, cloud providers we have to understand first point. Okay. Cloud services is different. Cloud services are nothing but in this console, this is what AWS management console. You have to have an AWS account. Okay. Once you have an AWS account, you should be able to log into it. And once you log into it, this is what your management console looks like. And in this management console, every single, you know, icon is a single service. Now, when you come under compute, compute is nothing but per computers or servers. So under that we have EC2. What is given are a little description underneath of that. It's a virtual server in the cloud. So whenever you need to build a server, you need to go into EC2. Then you will be able to create a server for you. But you need to know how to create a server, how to utilize EC2. Okay. So you need to understand all the parameters to create a server using EC2. EC2 is nothing but a server, a virtual server. So we say EC2 instance. Clear? So that's a server. That's a service. Then when it comes to storage, we have S3, that is a storage service. Then Cloudfront, this is another service which reduces the latency in accessing the data. Okay, Glacier is another service to, you know, move all the files into Amazon's S3. Okay. And we'll understand what's Glacier, that is archiving. Archiving is nothing but people who knows something about backup will understand what's archiving. It's a kind of backup like cut paste. Backup is copy paste. You have an additional copy. You have a copy in your local machine and also an additional copy in other remote location. But what happens if your space completely gets full? You delete some files from your local machine and then keep it or write it into CD and keep it safe, right? The same way, Glacier, archiving. Archiving is nothing but what? You delete from your local machine and keep somewhere in a remote location. Cut, paste. So that is another service, Glacier. Then when it comes to database, see, we can build an infrastructure using this AWS. So infrastructure will have servers, databases, storage, network, security, all does. Okay, so databases, when it comes to databases, you'll have relational database services like MySQL, PostgreSQL and all, then DynamoDB, NoSQL. These are the two different relational and non-relational databases. Then when it comes to networking, VPC, you know, you have an infrastructure into this cloud. And as I said, any number of people can establish their infrastructures into this cloud. So what happens if you get the access of your infrastructures for somebody else? They will be able to log into your infrastructure and then do something nasty. So they may, you know, harm your infrastructure. They may destroy it. So you should not provide any access, and that should be dedicatedly assigned to you. Your resources should be isolated only for you. So that isolation can be done under this VPC, virtual private cloud. This is another service, networking service, Route 53 domain name service. We will understand that clearly. Then, okay, you have infrastructure built in cloud. So do you do that all alone, or in an organization, there will be a team, couple of people working for that building infrastructure in the cloud. So we say cloud engineers. So how do you set those people to access your management console and then develop your infrastructure into the cloud? So you create them as users and set their restrictions, or sorry, set their level of access, like if you create users and you know, set their level of access by chmod. You discussed that the other day, right? Setting the permissions to users to access the files and folders, chmod 777-444-666. The same way, what level of access you wanted to provide to your users or your, you know, cloud engineers, so that they log into this and then work on different services. So that's possible under this security and identity access management. So these are all the different services which we are going to handle throughout our course of AWS. Then CloudWatch, it's a monitoring stuff, how your infrastructure is, how healthy it is, what how healthy your CPUs are, your servers are, all that stuff can be managed here in this. Then after that, you know, we will be talking about notification services, simple notification service. Then we speak something about simple emailing service, simple queue services, simple workflow services. So these are all various services which we will understand throughout our course, which we will discuss. Okay, hope you are clear with different services provided in the cloud, and there are different cloud providers in the market. First you need to understand what type of cloud we have. We have two different type of clouds, public cloud and private cloud. Public is accessible to everybody, like AWS is a public cloud. Apart from this, you know, AWS is provided by Amazon. Amazon is a company, it owns AWS, and there are other cloud providers when it comes to public. So that's nothing but Microsoft. When you take, it's Azure is the name, like AWS. Azure is a cloud provider, public cloud. Then when it comes to Google will have Google only. Then when it goes to IBM, they have soft layer, that's a cloud service. So a number of cloud providers are in the market. Then next, when it comes to private cloud, see, what's the difference between public and private? Private, the cloud which is built only for your organization, nobody else can build their organizations into it. When it is public, any number of people can access that, any number of organizations can be built into that. And the other difference is, when it is private, the cloud will be provided from a data center. You should have a physical data center, from that the cloud is created, and in that your infrastructure is built. So anything happens, any problem arrives, you should identify what is the root cause into that, and then you should yourself fix that, whether it is in the cloud or whether it is in the physical hardware. So you should identify anything it is. You are the responsible for everything when it goes something wrong, and identify, fix it. But in public cloud, if something goes wrong, you should notify the cloud provider, so they'll come up with a solution or with a fix. Then they'll suggest you to, you know, manage in a proper way based on their instructions. Then you can rectify your problem. You're safe. So that is another thing. And here in your public, you need not to maintain any data centers. You need not to have anything physically. So there is no, you know, nothing to worry anything about physical disasters. But in case of private cloud, all the data center will be in your location. If something goes wrong, if some disaster happens, then your entire infrastructure collapsed. That's another challenge with the public private cloud. But security, you will have a high security. Nobody else can access your infrastructure using private cloud. And the private cloud providers, if you have Red Hat, like your Linux, Red Hat people are providing a private cloud that is OpenStack. And VMware, you may be having an idea about VMware. People are providing a private cloud, that's VM cloud. So these are the two public and private clouds as of so far I know. So that's all about clouds, different clouds. Are you clear with all those stuff? Have any doubts to be clarified? Is there anything you wanted to clarify, anything you wanted to, you want me to repeat? Hello? Fine, that's fine. No news is a good news. No, fine. So tell me guys, you have time. Shall we enter into our cloud resources and go start with some service today? Or we are overburdened? Yeah, Usman, what's that question? You can talk to me, not an issue, or you can just type, you can enter your question here. Fine, fantastic. Why should we go for AWS? Which means among all the different cloud providers, why AWS? Or initially why AWS rather we have a physical data center? I think I have discussed the difference between physical data center or a data center in the cloud. It's time consuming when it comes to physical. So in cloud, you can create our infrastructure very easily. Okay. And physically, you have to spare a lot of time to build your infrastructure, but in cloud, in less time. And economically, you have to spend lakhs of rupees when it is physical. When it is cloud, in the cloud, you need not to spend lakhs of rupees. You can just spend some thousands of rupees. That's all. You can just run your show. And you are going to pay only the amount of time you utilize the services. That's between physical and cloud. And out of all those clouds, why AWS? That's a good question. Because you see, AWS, now let me tell you. Okay, just let me show you. In AWS, why AWS? It's because Amazon, first thing, out of these 5 points, the pay-as-you-go model is best suits to Amazon. Amazon, of course, all the public cloud providers will do that, but Amazon is providing all the cloud services for the lowest and cheapest prices. Okay, for the very cheapest price, it's providing its resources. Okay, let's just type AWS pricing. To just look at AWS prices. Or let's say instance price. Okay, it is providing you for a low and very cheap rates. This is all about free tier eligibility. And after once that is done, your infrastructure, okay, this is, I think, the pre-tier non-expiry offers. That's all about pre-tier is mentioned. See, check this. These are the different type of servers we have in our cloud. We can just go with these many servers, type of servers. They are different from their RAM size, CPU size, and the space with that, and the number of virtual CPUs for a server. So based on all that configuration, it is different in with respect to that. You can just have maximum of 36 CPUs. Okay, 36 CPUs and what's this, 116 to 44, variable up to 116, okay, so ECUs. that memory is up to 244 gigabytes of RAM you can have. If it is, now for every tier account, we are eligible to have this T2 micro instance or server. It is with one CPU and 1 GB of RAM. Okay, 1 gigabyte of RAM. Then how much is it is charged per 0 point? Always AWS charges you in terms of dollars. So now today in the market, it's $1 cost around 67 rupees 44 paise, something like that, which I have just checked yesterday. I don't know today how much it is. So it is for every server, okay, for every server of T2 micro, it is charging $0.013 per hour. Okay, so 0.013, that you multiply 0.013, let's say, just calculate that 0.013 into, let's say, 67 rupees only, anything it is. So it's not even a rupee. For an hour, you are spending lesser than, it's nothing but 87 paise in our Indian currency. Close to 1 rupee or 90 paise we speak about. For an hour, if you are charging, if you are paying 190 paise per day into 24, you do it. So how much you are charging? You are paying 20 rupees per day or 21 rupees, we'll say. So for one server, you are paying 21 rupees per day. And if you wanted to run your server for 30 days, maybe for 1 month, how many days? 30 days. So how much you are paying? 627, close to 630, we'll say. So 630 rupees you are paying. Will that be a huge price? What we are paying for a normal server with one CPU, 1 gigabyte of RAM. All right. So this is twice to that. When you have one CPU and 2 gigabytes of 2 GB of RAM. So this is how you can just calculate how cheap it is. So Amazon is providing you everything in a cheapest way, and it is not here for any profits. And whatever the least income it is getting towards its website or cloud services, it's again investing into the same thing to build their infrastructure, to expand their infrastructure so that they can provide their cloud services to across the globe, to entire globe. How is that possible? Amazon is a US based company. If they have their infrastructure in the US itself, and from US if they wanted to serve, they may have some latency issues. So in order to avoid, what Amazon is doing, it's expanding its infrastructure across the globe, not only being in US. So how, what way it is happening? Let's just go see here. I'm just currently in Tokyo region, but there are 10 regions Amazon has its data centers. These 10 regions are just 10 geographic locations where their data centers are existing. But in each region, they have minimum of 2 data centers. Minimum of 2 data centers. So you are in India, but your client is in US. So you build your infrastructure in US. Okay. Once you create your account, you are allowed to do anything in any of these 10 regions, irrespective of your, client or your purpose, whatever it is. So your client is in North Virginia, you create that infrastructure in North Virginia so that your client can access it without having any latency. You work by being in India. You need not to fly all the way there and then explain to that people and, safeguard everything, or you establish entire data center over there and then come back. Nothing like that. And you have a client from Singapore, then you build your infrastructure in Singapore, then serve. So this is how Amazon is very popular in the market, and 70% of the market is captured by Amazon, and then next position is given to Azure, Microsoft Azure. These are the leading public cloud providers. So that's why Amazon is in the first place. Okay, are we okay with that? Yes. Anything else you wanted to clarify? If no, please tell me. You have time, you have patience. Yes, we'll go into this and then start with the topic. If not, we'll continue tomorrow. It's up to you, totally up to you. What do we do? Please drop your inputs. Which one is ready? Yes, we can go ahead. What about the rest? Guys, Prashant, Praveen, Chandra, Srikanth is also fine. Hope the others are also fine. I think one guy has left with that. Chandra is also fine. Good. Now I think, hope Prashant is also fine. Praveen, Prashant are also fine, I guess. Dilip. I think Shilpa has left the session. Is there any problem with Shilpa's network or she's done well herself? That's fine. So almost 50% of the guys are ready to go ahead and continue with the session. I'm considering that. So what we start with today is, we'll start with a little basic thing, very easiest thing, okay? With that we'll continue, then slowly, one by one, we'll enter into. Usman, I'm recording it from the beginning, it is recording, not to worry, that will be shared with you. It's not now, from the beginning it is being recorded. So as I said, hope you have an idea that what and all the services we are going to cover. I'm going to, quickly recap once again what services we are going to discuss. EC2 under compute level. Little we'll speak about Lambda, but EC2, remember, it's very, 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 very important topic. The EC2 is, there are so many things, so many parameters we have to understand in that EC2. It's not only building a server, it is about so many things we speak in under that EC2. So whenever I start EC2, please make sure you listen to me very clearly and understand any doubt, not only about EC2, anything, any doubt which comes into your mind, drop your question there itself. Whenever I find that needs to be addressed, I'll address that question and then clarify your doubt then and there itself. Okay, please do not be with doubtful mind and have trouble yourself. Then EC2, that's, very pretty much important. Once you're done with your EC2 class, almost 40% of our AWS course is done. So understand how critical and how important this is. Then next comes to S3. We see practically these two things, S3 Cloudfront, pretty much we discuss. This is storage and latency services. Glacier also we will see. I'll show you how to do that, but not really. And we speak something a very little about elastic file system under EC2 level. And under EC2 level, we also see CloudWatch. Then, so those services are also covered here only. Then Snowball, Storage Gateway, we will discuss something theoretically. And then next go to database. So database is, under database we speak about RDS, DynamoDB practically, then Elastic Cache, Redshift we speak theoretically. And then networking we see VPC, Route 53 practically, hands on. Then this is what we are going to start with, identity and access management, we say IAM in a short way. So we are going to start IAM and user management. So that's under security and identity. That we will see. After that we see SNS, SQS, SWF, these three things. So with that our course is done. If time permit, Raghu may discuss about CloudFormation if it is needed, if you feel that it is needed for you, because this CloudFormation is one particular service enables you to form your infrastructure, create your infrastructure, and to do that you should have an idea about all the other services whatever I have listed so far. Only when you have an idea about all the other services, okay, EC2, S3, Cloudfront, and all, then only you will be able to do cloud formation. And that's discussed only by Raghu in the end. Okay, if he wants me to do that, I may do. Okay, so that's not compulsory. We may go with this or we may not go with this. So don't keep this in your mind. Let's discuss. Start with IAM. What's IAM? As I said, identity and access management. So why do we need this? Manage users' access. So, okay, now in the real-time environment, for example, okay, now you are working for an organization. Let's say you are working for one company. For example, it's TCS, for an example. Now I'm a client. Okay, I wanted one web application to be built and that web application to be built in cloud because it is cheaper than rather going with a physical data center. So when I say, again, now I wanted my application to be designed in this way, that way, that way. I have given all my inputs and my requirements to you. Then what you do, being a project head, either of you, you decide, okay, fine, we are done with that. You call your cloud engineer and say, okay, this is how we wanted to build his infrastructure in the cloud and then wanted to develop his application. Will that be possible? Then the cloud engineer, either of you, says, yes, we are aware of building the infrastructure in the cloud and that's possible, whatever the requirement he's having, I'm having. According to me, you say it's fine, it's possible. But is it possible to create that entire infrastructure to work for that cloud team? I'm giving you one project, but am I the only one giving you a project? TCS is a big company, so that may have n number of, you know, projects with that. And all those n number of people will be supported by the cloud team. So there will not be one particular person. There will be couple of or multiple people, multiple cloud engineers work towards a project. When multiple cloud engineers are there, everybody should be able to log in to this account. So when I say initial, you know, though I have n number of projects, I will have only one account because AWS is such a frequent and easy thing that one account is enough for you to create any number of infrastructures into it for any number of projects. When that flexibility is there, why will I go create multiple accounts for multiple projects? That's not possible. That's not needed at all. So one account is there. And in that one account, I should provide an access to all my people, all my cloud engineers to log into this management console and work with. So now one question arrives here. Do I have to give entire access, root access to all of my cloud engineers? Is that suggested? Say yes or no. Now you are learning Linux. Okay, you have created a file. Do you give root access of that file to everybody, all of your users? No, right? No, we do not usually give because root will be only one. Root will be only one and only one will have the ownership. Rest will be permission. The rest of access will be defined by the role and responsibility of that particular engineer. What that engineer is designed or set for, what level of work he needs to do based on his role and responsibility towards the infrastructure or towards the project, based on that, we define the level of access to that particular user, whether he can access to only EC2 and EC2 with along with S3 or some other services. So you can just, you know, set the permission based on the role and responsibility of that user. So how we do that, how we create a user and how we set that level of access, all that done under this identity and access management. Clear? So let's go into this. Now we are going into security and identity, under that identity and access management. Fine. Under this identity and access management, as I said, we are going to check creating users and all. Let's see, this is how the dashboard. Every service has its own dashboard. This is the dashboard of IAM, identity and access management. Initially, okay, whenever you have an account, AWS account created, and you wanted to share that with your resources, which sharing is nothing but giving an access to your resources, okay, you have to. Initially, when you wanted to log in to your AWS account being a root account holder, you need to go to a path, okay, aws.amazon.com. This is the URL or link to create your root account and to log into your root account. Okay, and we are not providing root access to everybody. Being a user, if somebody needs to access, okay, if somebody needs to access, we need to provide another URL which directly gives a permission to access into our account. So what is that URL? This is what IAM users sign in link. This is what that. So this can be customized. Initially, you know what? It looks like this. What way it looks like? It looks like that. The combination of numbers. What that numbers? That is actually the ID provided towards your root account. Whenever you create a root account, for every root account, they will, Amazon provides an ID. That ID is here. So it's not possible to remember this ID. It's not the sequential number. So we customize that up to us. That's what I have customized myself, because this is for just demos. So test 2016. That's what I've given. So this is what the link. So you need to provide this link to the users. Fine. And when that link is provided, people will be able to log in to your account. Now even myself have logged into my account as a user, because I myself have created me as a user and logged in. See, that's why it is mentioned IAM user Mohan and account test 2016. Hope this is clear for you. When you log in as a root, you will not see these two things. You will only see from here, my account, billing cost management, security credentials, switch role, sign out, something like that. Okay, fine. Now, what URL is to be given, that's clear. And how do you create a user? How that user can authenticate himself or herself? All right, a user always needs to authenticate by themselves. What way they authenticate? By providing their user ID and password. So how do you set that, and where do you set that? So first, you initially have to create a user and needs to set. The user, when you create, you will probably give a name. That name will be the user ID. And password, you need to generate it. Then only the person will be able to access other things. So today, what do we do is, we will see, probably I think we do not complete this today, because it takes another half an hour to 1 hour time to complete everything very clearly. So what I'll do, today I'll just discuss something, creating users, okay, and creating their passwords and all. If time permits, I may discuss something with groups also. If not, I'll end up the session with users, okay, possible, if possible with the groups. Then rest we'll discuss tomorrow. Done? So now let's see how to create a user and creating a password for him to log into this management console. So for that, to create a user, you can either go to users here, or you can go here, users, or you can go here, create individual user. This is very user friendly. You can do from anywhere. Only the thing is how, what options are to be selected, that you need to know, that's all. So going into users. Now currently I have 6 users under my account. I have so many. Even Raghu is also a user in my account. So So now what I'll do, fine, I'll just go create somebody as a user. I just need to show you guys, so I'm just going to create some new user. So anytime when you wanted to create users, you are allowed to create 5 users at a time, 5. So I'll say, I'll now create 2 users, like Lara, one user, and the other user, Max. These are the 2 users I'm creating, let's say, for example. And for every user, this is important. This is by default being checked. Generate an access key for each user. User needs access key to make secure REST or query protocol request to AWS service APIs. You know, with the APIs, when you wanted to log into the consoles, like, you know, to log into this management console, these are the usernames, Laura and Max, and password we generate. But of course, using these usernames and then the password which we are going to generate, you will be able to log into management console, and then of course with the permissions given to you, you have created a server, let's say, for example. Okay, and to log into that server, to access that server, do you every time log into AWS management console? Is that necessary? No, it's not necessary. Like, you have created a server, that's all. The server is provided to the users, and those users out there should be able to access directly, because we do not provide an access to everybody into our management console, AWS management console. That's not necessary. So when they need to access that server directly, how do they able to do that? Even they themselves have to authenticate, right? So in order to authenticate themselves, they need to have a username and then password. Those are not Lara and their password. Those are something different. So that's what this access key. When you create, the access key will be created along with that, and a secret access key is also created. That's what it is. So your two users have been created successfully. This is the last time these users' security credentials will be available, download. Okay? And you can manage and recreate these credentials at any time. Let's understand things clearly. So first thing is, show user security credentials. Is there any problem with Ravi? He's just coming in and going back. You know who is Ravi? He's part of you or he's a guest? Fine. So just if you wanted to see, just see here for everybody, like Laura and Max, both of them have got their access key ID and secret access. So why are they asking you to download these things? Because this is the only time you can just download this. You will be able to download this. And this is the only time you will be able to see your secret access key. Once you close this, you will not know what is the secret access key. And to understand, access key ID works as a username, secret access key works as a password. To log into that server or that storage directly without logging into AWS console. So when you say download, it will be downloaded in an Excel format, Excel sheet. That Excel sheet will be shared with these people. Done. I'm not going to do that because I'm not going to have these users. Later I'll delete them. Now you see, you haven't downloaded the user security credentials. This is the last time these credentials will be available for download. Yes, of course, I don't need. So go close. Done. Now, 2 users are created, Lara and Max. Okay. Now you see, they are not part of any group. That's fine, we will discuss about group later, little later. And password for Lara and Max, password is not created. One moment, guys. Yeah, sorry guys, sorry for the interruption. Now, so fine, we have created the users, but their passwords are not generated and their passwords are not used yet. So let's go create a password for Lara. Oh, we are into Max. Okay, fine, not a problem. We'll just create a password for Max. What do you want me to explain? IAM. IAM is, you know, to create users and setting their passwords. Not only setting their passwords, to also, you know, provide the level of access. What level of access you wanted to provide to your engineer. IAM is used. So it's all about user management. Okay. Or you want me to describe it even more clearly? That's what we are doing. We have created two users. And now we are setting the password to that user. So I said secret access key. Access key is seen, but secret access key is not visible. Nowhere you get that. Only once you'll be able to get that. So that is the reason why they ask you to download it. Since we did not download, fine. If you download, fortunately or unfortunately, you misplace it, how do you do? So you have an option here. You delete it, then recreate another one so that you'll be able to get another chance to get the access key, secret access key, and you'll also be able to download it for one more time because that will be another one. Fine, that's not a thing now. So here you see for Max, there is no password that needs to be created. So manage password to create a password, and here it is using last used NA, it is mentioned, but once created it will become none. So let's go change. So password, how do you set the password? Password can be auto generated, or if you have any default password to be set, the default password is what? That's in terms of like you have an organization, in that organization everybody will have some default passwords, like welcome@123, or welcome@ your organization, like TNS, something like that. So that you wanted to give can be given. I'll go with auto generated, and if your users wanted needs to reset their password after next login to their own customized password, so that is clicked over there. Then apply. Once you say apply, okay, it says show user security and credentials. You can see this is the password created. And this needs to be downloaded because you need to provide this password to your user, right? Max, how do you provide? That can be provided in terms of an Excel sheet once you download it, or you copy and paste somewhere. That can be done. I don't want you to do this because I'm going to delete these people. So close. Now you see, password is created, yes, and last accessed, never. Once you access this, let's go to dashboard and see now. Users. Once you access, see, password is created but not accessed yet. For this Lara, password is not created and it is not of the key. So this is what we create users and set their passwords. But how do you set their permissions, the level of access to your management console? That we will discuss tomorrow. Okay? From here onwards, we have seen how to create users and setting their passwords. The rest we will discuss tomorrow. Are we fine? Hope it makes sense to everybody. Everybody could get the points whatever we have discussed so far. Guys, are you there? I'm open to you. If there is anything to be clarified, you can ask me. If not, we'll continue tomorrow. Yes? Fine, and then closing this session. Good day. Bye-bye. We'll catch you tomorrow.